10 o'clock, must be time for worship. It's great to have the handbell choir back, if only in this version. We're going to hear them again in just a minute when we get to our prelude. We had hoped that today we were going to have a huge launch and have the choir and handbell choir and a whole lot of other elements. But we are continuing through this pandemic, and we're going to take our steps, and we are going to look forward to that day when it's going to be here. And hopefully soon. Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church in Charlottesville, Virginia. I'm the pastor, Alex Joyner, and if you are here in person, great to see you. If you're online, we're glad that you're joining us, whether you're at 10 o'clock with the live stream or later on the YouTube channel. So great to have you here, too. So this week, I don't know how you keep track of things that you need to remember, but this week I was here at the church, and my reminder buzzer went off on my phone, and it told me, remember the stalls, like horse stalls. And I thought to myself, I know I didn't say that. I know that's not what I did. And then I remembered. I told Siri, no, remember the stoles, like this, like what I wear around my neck, because I had some stoles that are going to Honduras that I had to take to my mother. So I remembered. All those memory devices are not foolproof, but they do help us. And boy, we have so many more ways to remember things today than we used to. Today, we're going to talk about memory. We're going to talk about how God gives us reminders to know and remember God's promises. I'm glad you're here for worship. Welcome.
I noticed that there was room for more handbell ringers up there. So if you're interested, see Kevin White after the service. And now let's, as we begin our worship today, stand and sing number 117, O God, Our Help in Ages Past.
Mm-hmm. Good morning. Please join me in the opening prayer. Oh God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. You remember us and hold all our days in the palm of your hands. We are still on the journey that led your people to new lands and new life. And you are still our way, our truth, our life. In Jesus' name, amen. The first reading this morning is from Deuteronomy 6, verses 1 through 9. Did I say chapter 6 or whatever? Anyway, it's about loving the Lord your God. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey so that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Can I invite the children to the front? Anybody else we have coming from upstairs? Okay. Oh, I think we got one more coming. Good to see you. And I saw you before the service. Did you see all those pictures that were going before him when the grandparents and grandchildren? And you were there. It was great. It was great. Hey, how are you doing? Charles? Good to meet you. Good to see you. Come on up. Hey, do you all see what I've got on my finger here? You ever seen anybody, everybody's seen anybody tie some string around their finger?
I sometimes accidentally do that.
You sometimes accidentally do that. Okay, yeah, that can happen. Especially if a present wrapping project is going really wrong, you can do that. Hey, good to see y'all. Good to have you up here too. Do you know why somebody might do that to put that on their finger in the morning on purpose? It's an old way of remembering. It's to put something there so that you look at it through the day and you say, "Why did I put that string on my finger? Oh yes, that's right. I'm supposed to get a watermelon at the store before I go home." Something like that, you know? It's a way of remembering. We have all kinds of other ways of remembering these days, but this was an old way of people would do this. They'd tie a string. You know, God gives a lot of reminders to us as people to remember God's promises, too. Do you remember what God gave Noah after the flood? What? What was it?
The ark.
The ark, that's right. But then after the flood and after they got back to dry land, there was a sign that God gave to Noah to remind us that God loves us and cares for all creatures. Do you remember what it is?
The rainbow.
Yes, exactly, the rainbow. That's right. The rainbow is kind of like a string tied on God's finger to help God remember and to help us remember God's promises to all of creation. You know what else we have?
The rainbow bridge.
Rainbow bridge. Boy, I want to hear about that. That would be interesting. So you know what else, another sign that God gives us? What's that?
A rainbow building.
A rainbow building. Okay, maybe so.
It sounds funnier.
It sounds funnier. Yeah, a rainbow building. Yeah. You've got a rainbow mask too. Yeah. God gives us grandparents. There are a lot of grandparents out here today, folks who help us remember. And if we're lucky enough to have grandparents in our lives, they can help us remember what God said and help us remember who we are. And maybe if you don't have a grandparent who's with you, you have somebody else. There are other folks that God sends to help us remember. So today, we're giving thanks. This is Grandparents Day. So we're giving thanks for grandparents, and we're giving thanks for all the people who help us remember who we are. So can we say a prayer for them? Let's pray. Lord, we are grateful for all the folks in our lives who act as to help us remember, whether it's our grandmothers and grandfathers, or whether we have different names for them, or whether there are other people in our lives who act in that way for us. So bless them all. Help us to trust in you, to trust that you'll continue to give us reminders like the rainbow in the clouds. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Thanks for coming up this morning.
Every week, we've been keeping you up to date on our preschool, and they opened on Tuesday, and it was so wonderful to see those little faces running through the hall and see them playing on the playground. Thanks to our trustees who made the playground sparkling clean, and they were just thrilled with it. There were some tears, but that's you know, kind of expected with little ones, right? But what we want to do throughout the year is really connect our congregation and our preschool. We're going to start by doing that this Wednesday with a coffee. At drop-off, these young parents will come in with their children and see Krispy Kreme and good coffee and some of us. And so I want you to pray for that time as we try to intertwine the preschool and the church and make it one. And just keep looking for ways to support the preschool. They have their Amazon wish list. But I think most importantly, is to build a foundation of prayer around them and above them and beside them and underneath them. So let's pray right now. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the opportunity to be in the lives of these little ones. Help us, Lord, to live our lives, to speak what we believe in such a way that they will understand and truly become those who would go out and help to build your kingdom. Lord, help us to find ways to support the preschool. Help us to find ways to be Christian brothers and sisters to these young parents. We lift up our preschool to you right now. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Our second reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 4. Verse 25 through chapter 5, verse 2. So then, putting away falsehood, let all of us speak the truth to our neighbors, for we are members of one another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and do not make room for the devil. Thieves must give up stealing. Rather, let them labor and work honestly with their own hands, so as to have something to share with the needy. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only what is useful for building up as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with which you were marked with a seal for the day of redemption. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ has forgiven you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and live in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
When you're broken down and tired of living life, go round, and you can't find a fighter. I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out. Move mountains, we gon' walk it out. And move To breathe, but I know you feel like dying. I promise we'll take the world to its feet and move mountains, bring it to its feet.
Thank you, Lynn. So memory is a funny thing. I don't know about you, but I can remember some random days from my childhood in great detail. Like, I can remember going up the steps to my dad's office. He was had an office above the bank downtown, and there's just an ordinary afternoon. There's not like I met anybody on these steps going up to the office. But I can remember everything about that day. I can remember the way the steps creaked on the way up, the light coming in the window, the smell of the place, the chairlift that I always wanted to ride that Mr. Moore, who was a polio survivor, had to use to get up to his office. I remember all of this. Ask me what I had for lunch yesterday. I can't tell you, but I remember that day. Yesterday, we were all thinking about where we were 20 years ago, if we were alive at that point. And I can remember that day very clearly, too. I was at Greenberry's Coffee in Barracks Road Shopping Center, reading the paper, on my way to work at the Wesley Foundation. Suzanne called and she said, "Hey, the news is saying there's been a bomb at the Pentagon," or so we thought at the time. So this being the day before smartphones, I ran out to the car, listened to the news, and at that point, the word was, oh, well, there's been something at the World Trade Center, and a plane has gone into the building, and I thought, oh, it's like the small plane that hit it a few years ago. But by the time I got to the Wesley Foundation, of course, I gathered with students in that upper lounge, and we watched the whole morning, that whole terrible morning, as the second plane hit and the towers fell. And we called, I remember calling the elementary school to see if there's a way we could help. All those things were close to my mind, and I wasn't even in those places. There are other things, though, in my mind that are things that I thought I would never forget, and yet somehow they slip away. This ever happened to you? I remember I ran across an email this week, and it was from someone who on the Eastern Shore was really important to me for a while. We shared a lot of thoughts and encouragement on writing, and then he went off to run a newspaper in Washington State, and it was like he walked right out of my mind. And I thought, I saw the email, and I said, Jim Fawcett, how could I have forgotten Jim Fawcett? It's funny how memory works and doesn't sometimes. How do we hold these things in our minds? Moses was gathering the people to prepare them for the journey into the Promised Land. They've been traveling this direction for 40 years. And he was helping to prepare them to go into this new place. But the generation of Moses was not going to be the generation that was going to enter the land. The folks who had walked through the bed of the Red Sea, fleeing from Pharaoh's chariots, was not going to be the same generation that was going to walk into the land. These folks would have their own bed to travel through, the Jordan River, when the water rolled back. So Moses had to remind them, to tell them, again, about God's promises and God's expectations and rules. And so that's what we heard in this reading from Deuteronomy today. Moses is saying, do these things, and it will go well with you in this new land. Remember these things, and you will flourish. Remember the one thing that's hard to keep in mind, that the Lord your God is one God, is God alone, and love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and might. And so, and then love God and love your neighbor came along in that discourse as well. So Moses was preparing them to enter and gave them strategies to help them remember, and said, recite these things to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're walking down the road. Talk about them when you're lying down at night and when you rise up in the morning. Bind them to your hand. Strap them on like the Orthodox Jews do. Fix them to your forehead like maybe the sensor of for a brain scan. Write them. Put them on the doorpost of your house. Use it like parchment so you can remember them. These are the ways God cares for a forgetful people, giving us ways to remember. As we've been unpacking boxes, I've been telling you about that. Every so often, I run across things that were important to me at an earlier stage in my life. You know, there'll be a baseball signed by Brooks Robinson from a game at Memorial Stadium. Or maybe they're the shoes that Suzanne and I wore when we were clogging, dancing out at the Greenwood Community Center. Or maybe old cassette tapes from when I was a disc jockey at WPED Radio in Crozet. 102.3 FM, the best country. All these things, all these remembrances of times past, and all these things that you try to hold on to, but we change. We change through time. And it's hard to hold all those old selves within the new self that we become. And I think about all those former stages of my life as having a kind of provisional coherence, you know, that was enough to hold together to give me a sense of who I was for that time. And I was just awaiting the next time when we had to go through that exercise of reorganizing your life for a new stage in life. You've been there too. And it takes a continual act of retelling that story of who you are and remembering who you are to have a greater narrative and a greater sense of who you are. One of the most painful things about illnesses that rob us of our memory is that we lose that sense of coherence. And I know there's some of you in this room who've had that very painful journey of walking with a loved one who's gone through dementia or Alzheimer's. And I've heard people say, you know, it just seems like my mother is lost. It seems like my spouse is not there anymore. And yet, I have sat with people who couldn't register who I was, couldn't carry on a conversation. And I'll begin something familiar like the Lord's Prayer or Psalm 23. And before I finish the first sentence, they're with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I'll say, and they'll respond, I shall not want. Ultimately, we all lose our coherence. Bodies fail, minds fail. It's just what it means to be human. But one of the promises God gives us is that the Word endures. The Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God. God's Word spoke us into being. And God's Word knew us before we knew ourselves. And so at the end, ultimately, because God's Word endures, we are held in God's memory. It's a great thing to be able to remember and to remind ourselves of God's promises. It's a greater thing still to be remembered by God. So our hope rests not in finally getting it all together and being self-sufficient, but in being human and trusting that God's memory of us is enough. That when we forget our own names, God does not forget us. And that's what we pass on to our children, is that trust. We pass along these practices of hope. We recite God's intentions for us and the rules for life, and it's good for them and it's good for us because it helps us remember. The best way to learn something, they say, is to teach it and to live it. And we think that this passing on task is something for professionals. The preachers should do it, or saints of some kind. Surely God is not entrusting this to us. We're not elders in the faith, are we? What the Ephesians passage tells us today is that indeed we are the ones that God is looking for. And that you do have the capacity. And Paul goes on to spell it out in every situation. We have the capacity to live without destructive anger. We have the capacity to work honestly and to share. You do have the capacity to build others up with your words rather than tear them down. You do have the capacity for forgiveness. And you have all these capacities because you know that you've been given a new life in Christ. And because Christ built up and forgave and loved and sacrificed himself, we know what those things look like. We can be imitators of God because we've been loved by Christ. And we can be elders because we are children. Isn't that a neat paradox? You can be an elder because you are a child of God. That's who the children of God are in this passage, the people who are called to imitate God. And God helps our memory by directing us to be children over and over again. We're continually moving through life, discovering who we are by returning again and again to this truth that in Christ we are the children of God. And in Christ, our lives get their true coherence that can't be taken away. In God's words, we hear over and over again about God's foundational claim on us. We hear the promises that we will flourish like the people of Israel in the good land. We hear the command to love, the same in Deuteronomy as it is in the Gospels, to love God and neighbor. And we hear the call to pass on this word to our children and our children's children and our children's children's children. The Elizabethan era poet John Donne was also an Anglican priest. And I love John Donne because he was really human. He didn't pretend to be holy, much less holier than thou. And he knew that he had a dark side, and he used that dark side as a way to try to grow closer to God. So in a hymn, in a poem that he wrote called A Hymn to God the Father, Donne plays with his last name. He spells it D-O-N-N-E is his last name, and he plays with that in this poem. And in this poem, he's talking to God and asking for forgiveness for sin. And he says in the poem, "Wilt thou forgive that sin through which I run and do run still, though still I do deplore?" It's kind of like the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 7, where he's struggling with the continuing presence of this old self, even as he's trying to live out this new life in Christ. It's still there, and John Donne knows it. He knows as much as he has been uncovering his life, he's still in the grip of sin, and that he's still continuing in a sin that he deplores. And so he goes on, and in this poem, he's asking God for forgiveness, and he ends the first stanza by saying, "When thou hast done, thou hast not done, for I have more." In a way, he's saying, when you've done that, God, when you've forgiven that sin, come on back, because there's plenty more where that came from. I've got more. And he worries a little bit because this is where the wordplay comes in, because he says, "Thou hast not done." Does God really have me? Does God really have John Donne? Can I trust that God has me in the midst of this power that I can't seem to overcome? And so in the second stanza, he goes on, and it's a lament. And he laments. He laments the sin that has caused him to cause others to stumble. And he laments the sins that he's repented for, but oh, he's wallowed in the memory of them for a long time since. And he ends the second stanza the same way. "When thou hast done, thou hast not done, for I have more." And then in the last stanza, the third one, he turns to his fear. And he says, "I have a sin of fear, that when I have spun my last thread, I will perish on the shore. But swear by thyself that thy son will shine as heretofore. And having done that, thou hast done. I fear no more." There's that wordplay coming all the way back around. At the end of all things, John Donne doesn't put his hope in his own ability to uncover all those places that he still needs to repent of. That's a never-ending task. In the end, his hope is in the promise that Jesus will continue to shine, that Jesus shines still, and that God's promise that is true means that God has done. God has the man, and he fears no more. So I think about that in terms of memory because I know that every day, in small ways and great, we have this niggling fear. The small way is you walk out the door in the morning, you go, oh, I feel like I forgot something. For me, it's always the keys to the car. But in great ways, it comes in much deeper ways. We think back on who we have been. And all the things that we have left undone in the past. By the way, that was John Donne's lesser-known cousin, John Undone. So, the good news is that somehow God holds all things. God holds all things and gives us reminders and tells us how to remember. Recite these things over and over to your kids. Talk about them. And you're going out and you're staying in. Love God and neighbor. Forgive. You can do all these things because Christ did that. And all those things that are undone, God has done. God has done. And God has you. Thanks be to God. Amen. Once again, we're going to begin our prayer time by singing the words of a call to prayer called, Lord, Listen to Your Children Praying. And we're going to sing it through twice. Thankful to Kathy Berlin, who's coming in. Kevin has had to leave because he's gone to Nashville to a conference, so we're had a plane to catch. But Kathy is going to lead us through the rest of the service, and John is here as well. I'll close each section of the prayer that follows with the words, Lord, in your mercy, and if you would respond, hear our prayer. And in those spaces that are left, feel free to offer your own joys and concerns aloud.
Lord, listen to your children pray.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Listen to your children praying for the land, for all the creatures that live on it, for all the injuries it suffers, for the ways we are renewed when we walk outside on a sunny day, for the ways the earth is renewed by the wind and the rains. Lord, hear our prayers for the earth and your creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, listen to your children praying for those who hurt, for those whose lives have been upended by the pandemic, for those who are remembering this weekend, the traumatic events of 20 years ago, and for all those unfinished stories that we remember. We pray for those who care for loved ones, and especially we pray today for those who live with dementia or Alzheimer's or other illnesses that rob us of our memory, for those who got bad news from doctors, and for those who found new reason to hope when they got a phone call from far away. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Listen to your children praying for this church, First Church, and for this city of Charlottesville, for the ministry of this church, and for the people who look to it for a hopeful word, your word. Listen to your children praying for our home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, we gather these prayers with the prayers of all your people in all times and places as we join in the words that our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank all of you for remembering to bring in your masks. So all of our baskets are starting to be filled up with masks. That's great. We're going to send them off to Haiti. Remember, they can't use the disposable masks. So if you'll just remember to bring in either handmade or store-bought ones that can be washed and reused again, that would be wonderful. Next Saturday, the 18th of September, at 2 o'clock in this very room, will be a memorial service for Dr. Ron Comfort, who passed away Palm Sunday of 2020. And so that'll be a time of celebration, remembering a life well lived, a faithful servant. I know that Marilyn Comfort would love to see many of your faces that day.
All right. And we have one more surprise today and a good announcement, and that is that this week we are welcoming a new member of our staff. The staff parish has been doing interviews and preparing this, and we've been preparing for some time, and I want to welcome Kathleen Mueller, who is our new Director of Communications and Technology. So would you welcome Kathleen to the service? She didn't officially start till tomorrow, but she was willing to come in and watch the operation today, and we're looking forward to all the ways that, especially our online experience, is going to improve. So thank you so much, Kathleen. Great to have you here. Before we move to our last hymn, I have a short video to show you. And this is one of the things that many of you have had a chance to do with me is to sit down and have me ask you some questions as a way of getting to know each other. And I've been pulling all of that information together as we prepare for a visioning process this fall. And so for the next few weeks, I want to share with you a little video about what I've learned about who we are in this new phase. So today, particularly, we're talking about our identity and who we are, and that's what this little video is about. In my experience, when you ask church members what adjective you hope people would use in describing their church, you're almost sure to get the answer friendly or welcoming. I've even heard it from a church where not one person said hello to me when I walked through the door on a Sunday morning and found my way to a seat with everyone watching me. So I expected that I'd hear that when I started asking that question about First Church. And sure enough, that's one of the most common things I heard in investigating who we are. We want to be, hope to be, a welcoming church. What else is part of our identity? The next most common answer I got is that we are a downtown church. We're that church with the high steeple right at the park and right where the streets change from east to west. We're a downtown church, but many of our members don't live downtown, which leads to the question, how do we connect to the place where we are? Another response I got frequently is that our mission and outreach activities help define us. One person told the story of how when they identified what church they attended, someone said, oh, that's the church that helps people. With ministries like the Soup Kitchen on Monday, Pacham Ministries for Unhoused Individuals, and Loaves and Fishes Food Bank, First Church is meeting needs in the city of Charlottesville. And beyond Charlottesville, the connections to Haiti, Lithuania, the Appalachian Service Project have all been important in forming us in our faith. Music came up frequently. People appreciated the excellence of our music programs and talked about how participating in choirs and bands and special programs has been important to their faith development and to their sense of connection.
Children and youth ministries have also been an important part of who we are and who we hope to be. There was concern that we continue the work that we have done through the preschool, through youth programs, and through children's ministries. I also heard a number of responses about diversity, an appreciation that this congregation has been able to stretch to include different kinds of people, that it's been able to maintain connection between people of different political and theological perspectives, that it's been a place of welcome and advocacy on behalf of LGBTQ persons, a voice on issues of racial reconciliation. And I also heard concern that we may not be as diverse now as we have been in the past.
All these things say a little bit more about who we are. The God questions haven't shown up in this little summary, but these things tell us a little more about our soul. And yes, churches and institutions have souls too. Parker Palmer talks about the soul in his book, A Hidden Wholeness. He says, the soul is like a wild animal, tough, resilient, resourceful, savvy, and self-sufficient. It knows how to survive in hard places. Yet despite its toughness, the soul is also shy. Just like a wild animal, it seeks safety in the dense underbrush, especially when other people are around. If we will walk quietly into the woods, sit patiently at the base of a tree, breathe with the earth, and fade into our surrounding, the wild creature we seek might put in an appearance. We may see it only briefly and out of the corner of an eye, but the sight is a gift we will always treasure as an end in itself. That's what we're doing as we move into this new phase of visioning as a church. First Church has a soul that has allowed it to survive in hard places like these last few years of pandemic and racial dynamics in the community and turmoil around sexuality issues in the denomination. The three crises that Harry Kinnon talked about this summer in a sermon. It also has a soul. First Church has a soul that is emerging and that we want to approach cautiously and humbly and to get a glimpse out of the corner of an eye. We'll get another witness next week. So come back and hear more. We're going to close with a more contemporary hymn. I'm going to let our music team take over.
Today we'll close with a contemporary hymn called Who You Say I Am. Again, thank you to Kathy for taking over for Kevin and John McLean over here on guitar. Would you stand? The words will be on the screen. I tell you what, we were trying to keep up. We were. Instead of who am I, it's what key is this? Okay? Thank you.
Okay, so we're going to have to do that one again, since now we know it by the time. That's good. Thank you. So as we go forth today, just let me remind you that we have baskets at each door for you, and envelopes if you'd like to use them for your giving today. If you are a visitor today, if this is your first time with us, we have a gift for you, and it's out on the desk. Just go out, and I think the greeter will be there to help you, and we'd love to offer you a gift and to let you know how much we appreciate your being with us here today. We also continue to have the Portico Bistro? Portico Cafe is out on the steps, so I hope you'll come and join me outside and we can greet each other there. You are held in the palm of God's hands. God knows who you are. Go forth to remind the world that it is not God forsaken, but full of the presence of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.